care how many cocktail dresses we have in the wardrobe. The scene calls for an evening gown, so that's what I want. Well, I've had a terrible day. We start rehearsing for this episode tomorrow. So I want the gown ready by the time we get to dress rehearsal. Yes, I'm sure there's something in our inventory that would work, but I don't care what we have in stock. The scene calls for a specific type of dress, so that's what I want. No, I'm not willing to compromise on this. I compromise too much as it is. And I've seen the figures. I know we're nowhere near going over budget for costuming. If you have a problem with that, then take it up with Zach. He'll back me up on this. When I wrote the scene, I wanted Joy to come out in an evening gown that made her look drop-dead gorgeous. That's what I want, so make it happen. God, I miss the old days when you could just slam a receiver down on somebody. Cell phones have ruined the art of the argument. Afternoon, Jeffrey. Are you ready for today's show?
As ready as one can be, I expect, Mr. Bodenstein.
All right. What is it this week? What's wrong now?
Is there really any point for my being here? My character has so few lines in this episode. It's hardly worth my time to suffer through this tripe.
Tripe? Well, I wouldn't exactly call it tripe now.
Then you, sir, are oblivious to the meaning of the word tripe, even though you produce such an abundance of it on a regular basis.
How many times do we have to go through this? It is a sitcom. I have to write a beginning, middle, and end that fits into 22 minutes. I can't translate Homer's Odyssey every week and expect it to be something that people will laugh at.
At least you could make the effort. This drivel is an absolute waste of my talents as an actor.
Don't you think I've tried to write scripts that have some more substance? Stories that have more relevance to the issues of the world? Well, people don't want to be reminded what they've heard about all day long. They want to laugh.
I have nothing against making people laugh. In fact, it's more of a challenge to make them laugh than it is to make them cry. What I am against is this infantile level of humor that we must lower ourselves to in order to accomplish such a feat. Oh, if the bard were to read this, he would hang his head in shame.
Jeffrey, I'm sorry that we all won't have the Shakespearean training and experience that you have, but you can't fit Shakespeare into a 30-minute show. I'm also sorry that your precious bard wasn't the first to discover slapstick comedy, because if he had, it might have changed his writing style.
Never mention the bard and slapstick in the same sentence again. The comedies of Shakespeare were written for audiences of intelligence, not the common masses that we perform for. Let me ask you, have you ever attempted in your career as a writer to create an intelligent level of comedy?
Are you kidding? I have dozens of scripts that have nothing to do with physical comedy. But you know what? People don't want to read that. It is much easier to have people, to get laughs by having people run into a closed door or slip on a banana peel. I mean, people don't want to have to think to find humor, Jeffrey.
Perhaps if you would defend your work to the studio as passionately as you do with me, they might consent to give your higher works a chance.
Are you kidding? Don't you think I've tried? I have argued and pleaded until I'm blue in the face. But unless it's a Frasier or a Newhart, they don't want to see it. After 8 seasons, Pryde and Joy is not going to do an about-face and go from physical comedy to highbrow comedy. End of story. Live with it.
Never. I shall continue to protest these poor excuses for comedy until my voice is heard.
We hear your voice every time we hear it. It's like hearing fingernails scrape across the chalkboard.
You, sir, are a miserable excuse of a writer.
And you are a pompous windbag.
Why, you scurvy little kids.
Oh, no. Are you two at it again? Please, Jeffrey, for one day, spare us a soft story about the substandard quality of the scripts. We're all sick to death of hearing about it.
Naturally, Miss Fairchild, you would protest against all of this, as all the stories revolve around you. Why change what makes you such an icon to the uneducated masses?
I do not even want to get into this right now. I have enough problems of my own to deal with to bother sparring with you today.
Aw, what's the matter? You You bust a zipper on one of your Vera Wang dresses? Again?
Listen up, precious. I am not in the mood for any of your sass either. I have half of my... Oh my god! What happened to you?
You like them? You'd be amazed how much attention I've gotten just walking into the studio today. You should have been there when I went through the mall.
Dear heavens, Todd, have you had some sort of... allergic reaction that is centralized in your chest? Not to sound lecherous or anything, but those were nowhere near so abundant.
Ari, what have you done? There is no way Vax is going to let you do tonight's show that way. How in the world am I supposed to explain this?
Where is Zach? There is no way I'm letting you step on stage with those monstrosities. The audience will never take their eyes off of them. Where on earth did you get those dinosaurs back? Do you think I'm in front of white ants?
Oh, relax. They're not even real.
That's obvious. But they do look rather convincing. Are they still sensitive, or can I touch them?
Sure, you can touch them. I'll even let you hold them.
They're padded. You almost gave me a heart attack.
Of course they're padded. You think I can get a boob job overnight?
Child, this is Hollywood. These days, anything's possible.
Yeah, not without parental consent. I'm thinking about asking for them for my birthday. I just wanted to try them out first.
Why all of a sudden do you want a breast job?
Oh, let's see. Hilary Duff, Lindsay Lohan, Britney Spears. You think I can compete with the likes of them?
What makes you think you have to compete? You've been on a successful TV series for 8 years.
How long do you think that's gonna last? Sooner or later, the studio's gonna give us the axe. I'm just trying to think about my future.
Hey, if you've got a clause in your contract for residuals from reruns, you won't have to worry or think about working for years.
Valerie, you don't need enhancements to ensure your future. You have something far more valuable than those other ladies that you mentioned. You have talent.
Yeah. That, $10, will give me a mocha latte from Starbucks.
I seriously wouldn't worry about that at this point, Val. I mean, I doubt your parents would even consent to this.
You want to bet? If it'll increase the size of my trust fund, my parents would consent to me having 3 breasts.
Oh, good grief. I swear, kid, you are not so old you can't be bent over someone's knee and given a good old-fashioned spanking.
Ooh, I'm so terrified. I'll go pee my pants later, but I have more important things to do. Can I have that back?
Oh! Isn't there any way you can replace that snot-nosed brat? Ever since she turned 13, she's been an absolute monster! Why do we have to have kids on the show anyway? Will and Grace are just fine without them.
Well, it's a little late to get rid of her now. She's only been on the show for 8 seasons.
Accidents have been known to happen. You hear about it all the time.
For one, Shakespeare and I agree. You're the writer. Have her run away or elope or something.
And how in the hell am I supposed to make the sudden disappearance of your only child into something funny?
And not to worry, since nothing else you write comes across as humorous. This will just be par for the course.
You miserable son of a...
All right, all of you, that's enough! If you have so much built-up energy, try to save some for this show. We're supposed to be professionals? How about acting like it?
And once again, Prince Charming arrives in the nick of time to save the day. Good afternoon, darling. I missed you last night. Weren't we supposed to go out for dinner after rehearsal?
I know, Camille, but I felt a migraine coming on, and I wanted to get home before it completely overwhelmed
me. Oh, Lance, another migraine? You've been having quite a few of those lately. Have you gone to see a doctor about this yet?
I'm trying to get in to see him, but he's been booked solid for weeks.
Well, we'll just have to make up for the time that we've missed, won't we?
Jeffrey! Max, do either of you have anything else that needs to be aired out before we get started?
apparently I've let my temper get the better of me once again, and I apologize for any comments to which you may have taken offense.
Same here. Let's just get ready until Zach gets here, huh?
Zach's not here yet? That's unusual. He's usually here, ready to go before the rest of us show up. I wonder what's going on.
Good afternoon, Miss Summers. You're looking especially radiant today.
Why, thank you, Jeffrey. You're looking ravishingly dashing and handsome as always.
Oh, knock it off, will you? I just had lunch.
Me old smart. Leave her alone.
What? I never get any compliments on my appearance from Jeffrey. Or anyone else, for that matter. Everyone has nice things to say about Katie. Why doesn't anyone on this show compliment me anymore?
Perhaps it's the fact that Miss Summers knows how to accept a compliment graciously. Now you, on the other hand, you expect to hear flattering remarks as soon as you arrive.
Oh, cut the fancy dialogue, Jeffrey. What exactly are you trying to say?
What I'm saying, Miss Fairchild, is that if you would come down from your pedestal every once in a while and behave like a normal person, then instead of a diva, you believe yourself.
Diva? Diva! I do not have to take this from you, you son of... Oh! Lance, sweetheart, aren't you going to stand up for me?
I'm sorry, dear. I'm just a neutral observer on this one.
Well, thank you for your support, my knight in shining armor! If anyone needs me, I'll be in my trailer sticking pins in my voodoo dolls! One in the head for my loving boyfriend, Lance. And one in the posterior for Jeffrey, since he's such a pain in the ass!
Peyton, do you have the sketches from costuming I asked for?
I sure do. I picked them up right before I got here. I also have the invoices from the prop department for you to sign for next week's show.
Good. At least with the prop department, I know where I stand. I ask, they deliver. Why can't it all be that simple?
Okay, people, what are we standing around here for?
We need to get started. Lance, Jeffrey, I need you in costume. Tell everybody to get ready and get out here for a pre-show meeting. Peyton, is everyone here?
I haven't seen Hazel or Valerie yet.
Miss Pennings is here, and I'm assuming in her trailer. My devoted spouse has yet to make her presence known.
Here we go again. Why can't that woman ever be on time? Peyton, will you call?
Yes. I'm already on it. I'm trying the house, but there's no answer. I'll check her cell phone.
$5 says she's not even out of bed yet.
Why don't you just give your money away? You know Hazel has yet to be late to a start time. Granted, she might be half-slosh when she gets here, but that woman is nothing but punctual when it comes to performances.
True, true, but there is a first time for everything.
What about you, Zach? You're never this late on the show day.
We'll talk about it at the meeting.
Peyton, do you have the reading material I asked for?
Right here.
Why are we still standing around? Go! Go! Go!
Zach, is everything okay? You seem a little edgier than normal.
He's right, boss. Something's up. You want to clue us in?
I should, but I can only do this once, guys.
Is it that serious?
It could be. Max, how many episodes do we have ready to go?
The usual. There's 4 on the pipeline, and I should have the next one done by tonight, hopefully.
And how many more for the rest of the season?
Oh, 7, I think. What's going on?
Later. Why don't you two take off for a bit? I want to go over the script and make sure all the rewrites are in.
If you say so, I need to check with our caterers anyways. Last week, they used hypocrisy bun on Camille's sandwich, and all hell broke loose. Another tantrum like that, and we'll be looking for yet another caterer, and there's not that many left to choose from. Camille's got us blacklisted from all the really good catering companies.
You know, I miss Grub and Go. They had some of the best salads, and their bread was always baked fresh.
Grub and Go? Yeah, I remember them. They were pretty good, and they were around for a while. What happened to them?
When the head chef came in to see how everything was, Camille called him a reject from a greasy spoon, and that pissed him off. So he dumped a bowl of hollandaise sauce all over her head, and he told her to wear saucepans.
Yeah, that doesn't surprise me. That's the one that brought up the lawsuit, isn't it?
Only because Camille brought up one first.
Okay, enough traipsing down memory lane. Really, I need some alone time.
Hey, Nick! Where the hell are you? I need some help back here! Now!
Her Highness Bellows, I mean Beckons. Come in, Camille, don't get your panties in a bunch!
Zach, I'll be in my office. We just have Peyton buzz me when we're ready, okay?
Thanks, Max. I won't be long.
Mr. McMahon?
What? Oh, I didn't expect to hear this early.
I wanted to see how the cast gets along without an audience. Are they always this combative?
No, not always. Well, okay, maybe sometimes. All right, pretty much all the time. But once they get focused, they work great together. You've seen that.
I'm not concerned with their behavior on camera, Mr. McMahon. The concern is with how they behave when there's not an audience around. What I've seen so far does not convince me that this ensemble is what you would call compatible.
Look, after 8 seasons, no cast gets along 100%. They all know each other so well that there's just no pretenses anymore.
Still, the studio is concerned, and now I see they have every right to be.
Just don't make any decisions until after you've watched them for a while. I think you'll see the chemistry there.
I'll be the judge of that. Remember, not a word to anyone that I'm here. I want to see them in their natural behavior toward each other.
God help us all.
What was that?
I said, will that be all, sir?
Yes, Mr. McMahon. We'll speak again later.
Really looking forward to that. Hey, can you come to a pre-show check at the set? Just make sure we have everything. I know I usually do that, but I need to run to the studio infirmary for a minute. I'm out of antacids. You put some by my chair. What would I do without you?
Have an ulcer the size of Burbank by now, most likely. You still really want me to do that pre-check?
Please, I need to get some air. Just have everybody out ready to go by the time I get back. Have we heard from Hazel?
She's in her dressing room now. She's doing her makeup.
I swear, that woman is going to drive me to drink.
Yes, and I'm sure she would enjoy the company.
How bad is she this time? Is she pickled?
Worse than a kosher dill.
Fantastic. I'll be back.
Take your time. I'll marshal the forces.
You know, Peyton, you're undoubtedly the best assistant I've ever worked with. What is it about this bunch of lunatics that's kept you here so long?
The vain hope you give me a substantial pay increase.
It's not up to me, Peyton. If it were my call, you'd make more than I do.
What makes you think I don't?
Really, though, what keeps you here? I know you've had offers from other studios. Why do you stay?
Let's just say I've got my reasons. Now get out of here!
Hello? Anybody else here yet?
I'm in the kitchen.
Where's Zach?
Out. He said he needed some air. Where are the others?
Still in the middle of custom making, I guess. So you mean we're alone?
Sure looks that way.
I missed you this morning. I never even heard you leave.
I had to get an early start. I needed to pick up specific items for Zach. But I missed you too.
I got your message on the bathroom mirror. Did you mean what you wrote?
You bet I mean it! I use that my most expensive lipstick. I don't do that just for any man, you know. When will you be home?
Hopefully by 9. I'm supposed to have dinner with Camille first. According to publicity, we need to be seen in more casual settings together.
I hate that campaign. Making you a couple off-screen as well as on-screen, it must be pure hell working with that witch.
Spending time with you more than makes up for it.
Anyone else in here?
just me, Valerie. I was just looking over things in the kitchen. Looks like you three should have some fun today.
I don't know if I'd call it fun, but it's been a good way to get out some frustration. I've been wanting to do stuff to Camille like that for months now.
Just as long as you remember that we do have an audience and don't get too carried away.
Don't worry about me, Daddy. I'll be a good girl.
Now that's what I wanted to hear. I gotta go round up the others.
Oh, and Daddy, since we're talking about good girls...
Yes?
You've still got some lipstick on your face. Might want to clean that up.
Yeah, about that.
Don't worry. I'm not gonna say anything, but I'd be more careful. If Camille finds out, she'll go berserk.
Yeah. Thanks, Val. I owe you.
If I were 10 years older, I'd call that marker in.
Okay, let's get this show on the road. Where is everyone?
Still in their dressing rooms. Want me to go get them?
Yes. Tell everybody to get out here right now, whether they're ready to go or not. We need to get this meeting over with.
Back in a minute.
You're going to tear into them again? We've all heard this more than enough times before, and it's still the same.
I've got to, Peyton. Somebody has to beat it into their skulls that they just can't run amok like this. What they do outside of the studio affects the ratings, and it just keeps getting worse.
What keeps getting worse, Zach?
In due time, Max, really. I can only do this once. All right, people. The first thing we need to cover... Where's Hazel?
I knocked on her dressing room door. I heard her do a spit take and then yell at me to go to hell.
And I meant every word, you wretched urchin.
Good morning, Poppets. How is everyone today?
Well, about half a day ahead of you, apparently. It's after 4:30 in the afternoon.
Really? Where does the time go? The last I remember was the crack of dawn.
That must have been when you went to bed. Everyone knows for a fact that you never crawl out of bed until after the crack of noon.
Oh, Camille, as always, you are as pleasant as a basket of rattlesnakes.
All right, enough. I am not in the mood for this today. The first thing we need to go over, did everybody get the rewrites from last night?
Yeah, Zach, about that. I had a couple questions. Are you sure?
This is what the studio wants, so this is what we're going to give them. End of discussion.
Geez, Zach, you're a rare form.
Who cracked in your cornflakes?
Well, as a matter of fact, Valerie, you did. You and the rest of this cast. Guess what, folks? The new tabloids are in, and you're all over the place. Val, there's pictures of here in here of you at a party with guys doing tequila shots off your stomach. Camille, you threw a prize temper tantrum at the SAG Awards. Hazel, I can't even repeat what you did on Saturday.
I wish you would, darling. I've been trying to remember that little episode for the past 3 days.
And then, to top it all off, we have a new entry in the headlines. It appears our own Lance Burroughs was seen getting cozy with a mystery woman, not Camille. So, who wants to be the first to try and defend themselves?
I will. The press has that whole sad incident blown completely out of proportion. I was there by invitation to present an award.
The story I heard was that you were called in as a last-minute replacement for Sandra Bullock, but when she showed up anyway, you still refused to let her present the award.
She told the producer she would be out of town. When I was asked to present in her place, I bought a new gown, had my hair and nails done, and completely rearranged my schedule to accommodate the awards. For what I went through, I had every right to present that award.
Right, but I also heard that you called her a scenery chewing hag and said that she needed a tummy tuck.
Camille, you didn't!
Oh, please. Go to the lake house and see if I'm wrong. As far as her body, marriage has obviously gone straight to her stomach and hips.
Now I see why we got that letter from the Screen Actors Guild.
Letter? What letter? What did it say?
Peyton, will you do the honors?
Here? Right now? Shouldn't this be handled in private?
Oh, no. Nobody has any privacy when it comes to the tabloids. Go ahead, read it.
The executive board of the Screen Actors Guild wishes to inform you that as a result of the incident involving Camille Fairchild at the recent SAG Award ceremony, a presenting, acceptance, and attendance ban has been placed on Ms. Fairchild for a period of no less than 5 years. To go into effect immediately, this decision has been agreed upon unanimously by the SAG board and cannot be appealed. Ms. Fairchild's conduct was considered shocking, appalling, disgraceful, and will not be tolerated.
What are they saying?
In a nutshell, Mom, you've been banned from the SAG Awards for 5 years.
That's not fair! They can't do that! I'll go before the board and explain. I will get this straightened out.
You can't! They said in the letter they won't listen to an appeal. They also said if there's any attempt to attend, it'll be considered trespassing and they'll have you prosecuted and arrested.
Oh, way to go, Camille.
Shut up, you twerp. At least I wasn't involved in a drunken orgy.
Well, Valerie, care to explain yourself?
Well, it wasn't an orgy. Some people may have gotten tipsy, but nobody got naked.
According to this photo, I would venture a guess that you were dangerously close to achieving nudity.
I was wearing a bikini. It's not exactly fun to do body shots off of someone who's fully clothed.
You let perfect strangers lick salt off your bare skin.
I had to do something. I wasn't about to partake in the drinking. Tequila is absolutely nasty. At least that's what I hear. Besides, there were people doing far worse at that party than what I was.
I'm sure there were, Valerie, but you were the only celebrity that was there. That puts all the focus on you, doesn't it? Which I'm sure you're quite familiar with.
So I want some attention. So sue me. You think it's been easy being a teenager in Hollywood and staying noticed?
Surely, child, there must be some way of garnering attention from your peers and the rest that someone less scandalous.
Bitch, please, what do you want me to do? Volunteer at a homeless shelter?
Actually, that would be perfect. It would show that you're aware of social issues and that you're compassionate to others who are less fortunate.
Yeah, and at best, give me a blurb in the entertainment section of the local newspaper. No thanks. I'm not ready for community service at this point in my career.
No, you're just ready to go from primetime television to strip clubs.
I keep telling you, I'm innocent. All I did was provide the body for the body shots. From what I heard, there was some crazed drunk woman there doing something obscene with a ferret. In front of an audience.
That's disgusting.
That's repulsive.
That's it. That's the way this happened.
I'm just glad there weren't pictures this
time.
Believe me, darling, so am I.
You're not surprised.
It must have been the vodka. Things always get a little hazy whenever vodka's involved.
Wait, so you and me were at the same party?
My God, gross is that? Purely coincidence, my dear. I heard about this little soiree in the grapevine and thought it'd be worth a look. Apparently, it must have been a good time.
Hazel, don't you understand? We're going to be lucky if the ASPCA doesn't sue us over this. Actually, Peyton, will you call legal? Thank you. So, while we're waiting to hear how bad this one's going to be, let's hear from Lance on these allegations of an affair.
Yes, darling. I am absolutely dying to hear this.
So what? I got seen out in public with a female friend. Is it a crime for a man to have a friend of the opposite sex these days?
When he's in an extended relationship with another woman, yes!
I thought this whole relationship thing was just a publicity stunt cooked up by the studio. You mean it's real now?
Yes!
No! I mean, it's not an exclusive relationship. We always said we could see other people if we wanted to.
I don't remember ever making that agreement.
Camille, sweetheart, you know I've never discouraged you from going out with friends. I never stood in the way of anything that was important in your life.
But you are what's important in my life. You and my career. I have always counted on having a stable partner by my side. And you have always been there since we started this show together. I think of you as my anchor. And I have always been able to come to you for emotional support. Now I find that you've been lying to me, and you're running around behind my back with some slut!
Hey! Who are you calling a slut?
Whoever the tramp is who got spotted and glanced by the paparazzi. Why are you so worked up over it anyway?
Well, I thought you changed subjects and you were calling Hazel a slut.
Please, I know better than that. It's obvious that Hazel's days of seduction are long over.
Now just a minute, you twit. I take that as a personal insult. Age has nothing to do with desirability. I can still be plenty seductive when I choose to be. Isn't that right, Jeffrey? Jeffrey, isn't that right?
I beg your pardon. Why am I being brought into this vulgar display of emotion?
I'm trying to defend our place in life, you old goat. She's saying just because we're old, we're not desirable anymore.
Oh, I'm not talking about Jeffrey. When he's played up, I happen to find him very desirable. He has a sophistication about him, and he radiates elegance. You, on the other hand, tend to radiate a stench of alcohol that could sterilize a garbage truck.
If I weren't a lady... artificially colored hairs of yours by the roots.
A lady? From the stories I've heard around town, you've been in more bar fights than Russell Crowe.
And I've won my fair share of those fights. And I don't have any qualms about chopping up one more mark in my win column to teach you the error of your ways.
This I want to see. It's about time someone knocked Camille off her high horse.
Hey, darling, come on, let's go. Get
away from me.
Touch me.
Got her, Hazel.
No, let me go. You two will not have to live with this. There's no way to trick her mother.
Yeah,
let me go, you rat.
know how much I beg and plead with the studio executives to keep this show going. Well, you know what? I've done. I've done fighting for any of you. So if you want to go out and have affairs, participate in drunken orgies, alienate yourselves from your peers by being a spoiled brat, or curse those who gave you a job because this isn't Shakespeare. Go ahead! I'm done fighting, I'm burnt out, and I don't even want to do this show anymore. Maybe I should be the first to quit. Where would you be then, No one else wants to touch this show. Live television is too risky, they say. Too many things can go wrong, they tell me. Well, here's a newsflash. I'm at my most relaxed for the 30 minutes when you yahoos are in front of the camera. It's the only time I can guarantee that you will relax and get along. It's almost time to go on the air. The audience is about to arrive. So you all need to get your heads out of your asses and act like professionals, if that's even possible.
Look, Zach, I just want
to
say—
No! Do not! Do not apologize to me! It is too little and way too late for that. I just want to get this show over with and get the hell out of here as quick as possible. Peyton, take over, get everybody ready to go for airtime. I have just enough time to go have a drink.
Hey!
And try and relax. I'll be back before airtime. Maybe.
This is not over, you know. I will have you fired before the read-through of the next episode.
Bring it. In case you haven't noticed, I'm not 8 years old. I'm not afraid of you.
Well, you should be afraid.
As should you. We're not finished yet either.
Stop it! Didn't the three of you hear what Zach said? It's not a game anymore. Cut the crap. If we're not ready, the network won't think twice about replacing us with Sabrina the Teenage Witch. Is that what you want? Now get to your dressing rooms, all of you! I said dressing rooms now!
Well, that was certainly interesting, wasn't it?
You're a writer, Max. Couldn't you come up with something more descriptive than interesting?
Well, how about traumatic, or intense, or at very least overdue?
Which part? The girls facing off each other or Zach's tantrum?
Don't forget your little unexpected show of forcefulness. You've never done that before, and Lord knows you've had plenty of opportunities.
Maybe I should have started a long time ago. Maybe this whole thing could have been avoided if I would have shown more backbone towards Camille from the start. If I start ordering people around, I feel like I'm stepping on Zach's toes.
Don't blame yourself for this. This little incident was a long time in the making. If Zach had brought it up today, it would have happened eventually.
It shouldn't have happened at all. We all know each other. We've been together for 8 years. Why do we keep testing each other's limits instead of supporting each other?
Too much togetherness.
Excuse me?
It's too much togetherness. This cast has worked closely together without the benefit of having many extras or guest stars to keep everybody on their best behavior. I mean, let's face it, this set is the only home we've all really known. I mean, what we really need to do is take some time apart, get back in touch with the world outside these walls.
It can't happen. I've heard through the studio grapevine that they're scrambling for mid-season replacement material, and we don't have enough to finish the season, or for the summer.
Maybe we can convince the network to let us do a short season.
It can't happen. If Camille quits, we can't do anything about that. But if she's fired, then... Well, the court battles will be in the headlines for months.
Well, that's probably our best option. Get rid of her, but she's not fired. The only way she possibly could leave willingly is to get a role in a motion picture.
Can't happen. I mean,
where does that leave us?
We're screwed.
Speaking of screwed,
Max Bodenstein, don't you dare go there.
All right. Pretty much answered my question anyway.
And what question is that, boys and girls?
Well, speak of the devil, of an innocent heir of Gregory. We are about to take your name in vain.
In vain? Me? Whatever for?
For not fulfilling your responsibilities as an agent and not getting a movie role for Camille.
If only it were that simple. Is she available?
You want to talk to her now? We're about ready to go into production.
I know that. That's why I came. I figure if I talk to her now, then she can't go into a full-blown tantrum after the show. And that buys me enough time to at least get out of town for a day or two.
All right. I'll go get her. Might as well get this over with.
Have you found anything out there for Camille?
Believe me, dear, I've tried. I've been around to all of the major studios, and even some of the minor ones. As soon as I mention Camille's name for a leading dramatic role, everyone thinks I'm telling a joke. Nobody believes she's got a dramatic bone in her body.
So, have you talked to the directors? You know, directly.
I've put in calls to everyone from Robert Altman to Robert Zemeckis. To them, Camille Fairchild is a dramatic box office poison, and everyone knows it but her.
Eric, sweetie, what a surprise! I'm so happy to see you!
Candy, honey, how's my number one client?
On pins and needles. I've been waiting days for the results of my last audition.
Audition? I've forgotten. Which one was that?
You know, the one for the movie that Penny Marshall's directed, the biography on Jackie Onassis?
Oh, yeah, that one. To tell you the truth, Camille, that's why I'm here.
They've chosen.
Maybe I should leave you two alone.
No, please stay. I want to make sure I'm not imagining this.
Yes, Peyton, please stay. I would really appreciate having a witness around. Just in case.
Did you say witness?
You know what I mean.
Unfortunately, I think I do.
Well, don't leave me hanging. When do I see a script and a shooting schedule? And what are we looking at as far as salary? $2-3 million?
Camille, you might not want to get so enthusiastic about this.
Why not? Eric, you know how long I've been waiting for this opportunity.
Yes, but you know how difficult this process can be.
Eric, what are you trying to tell me? Why would you be here if I wasn't offered the part?
Well, I know how upset you can get when you get bad news.
Upset? Do you know how it feels to hear, "I'm sorry," and you're just not what we're looking for right now, time after time?
Camille, is there anything I can get you? Like a glass of water or something?
The only thing you can get is out of my face! I don't want you to give me anything, and I do not need your pity!
Camille, it's just an audition. I'm sure there'll be others.
Who got the part?
What?
The part of Jackie? Who got it?
Why make yourself crazy about it? Who cares who got the part if it's not you?
I care! If I got beat out by a better-known actress, it makes a huge difference! If I got beat out by a nobody, I'm going to explode!
Like you are now.
You keep out of this! Why are you still here? Don't you have someone's dry cleaning to go do or something?
Why, you egotistical...
Ladies, we're all professionals here. Let's remember where we are.
Oh, cut the crap, you two-bit schmoozer. Did I even come close to getting the part?
Honestly, yes. It was down between you and one other actress.
Really? One other person? Well, who was it? What did they say?
Well, they said it was a very difficult decision. They said your screen test was excellent, and that the main reason that you weren't considered was the fact that your competition had a little more dramatic experience.
Oh my God! I can't believe it! Well, who was it? Who did I give a run for her money?
Oh, well, I really shouldn't.
Oh, come on! Was it Julia Roberts? Demi Moore? Nicole Kidman?
No, it was none of them. Actually, they were looking at someone a little younger.
Drew Barrymore? Natalie Portman?
No, not them either.
Well, who then?
It's really difficult to just come right out and say.
Who?
Really? You're gonna laugh when you hear it.
Tell me.
Dakota Fanning.
What? Who?
Dakota Fanning. You know, the girl from Hide and Seek and Charlotte's Web.
I know who Dakota Fanning is! You are telling me that I got beat out for
feel that Dakota has a more drawing power.
Wrong thing to say, Aaron.
Give me a breath, sweetie.
Bastard!
Just take a deep breath.
I am not going to take a deep breath, and I am not going to calm down. You're the most pathetic excuse of an agent I have ever met. You promised to get me into the movie, but I've been getting stuck on this ridiculous series since I had no say now. You are too comfortable getting a percentage of my salary year after year. Well, no more. I'm getting on the phone right now, and I'm going to call someone who's willing to work for my best interest. You are worthless. You are pathetic, and you are fired. Peyton, call security. Get this piece of trash off of my set and banned from the studio. Now!
Well, I'd say she took that better than I expected.
I'd have to agree. Last time, I had to go to the emergency room for stitches.
Eric, if she's that abusive towards you, why have you put up with it for so long?
You would never believe me if I told you.
Try me. With this group and everything I've heard today, I can pretty much believe anything.
I really should.
Come on, if you're gonna tease it to me this much, I need to hear the answer.
Oh, all right. I'm attracted to her.
You're what?
I told you you'd never believe it.
I need to find one of Hazel's flasks. I think I need a drink.
Hey, I know it's crazy. Camille is the most temperamental woman I've ever known. But when you get past her ego, there's really a very sweet, and warm, and loving woman there. I've seen her. Not very often. But trust me, she's there, and that's the Camille Fairchild that I'm loving.
Really? So what are you gonna do now?
Well, I guess I'll go back to my office and close out her file.
Are you serious? As many tantrums as she's put on you?
The tantrums are nothing. I've worked with her long enough to know she's just blowing off steam. But even through all that, she's never fired me before. Quite frankly, it's a relief. Regardless of how I feel about her, I'm tired of going through this every couple of months. The money that I've gotten representing Camille Fairchild doesn't even begin to cover the amount of grief I've endured. How have you done it all this time? You work with her almost every day. How do you handle the stress?
Oh, it's easy. I sleep with her co-star behind her back.
Oh, that's funny. That's really funny. You know what? If you ever decide to give acting a try, I want you to give me a call. I had no idea how comedically talented you were. Well, I'm out of here. I think I'm going to go knock back a couple of drinks and get my first good night's sleep in years.
Lucky you.
Take care of yourself, Pete. Don't let her drive you over the edge. She's not worth it.
Give my best to Dakota.
Don't you dare tell Camille that. If she ever found out that I also represent Dakota Fanning... she would probably put a contract out on my life.
You know, she also tracked you down and rip your throat out herself.
This is true. Sad, but true. Later.
See ya.
What in the world is going on? Camille's locked herself in her dressing room, screaming at the top of her lungs and destroying everything she can get her hands on.
I think Mom's gone psycho. Can we call the guys with the white coats?
I have to agree with young Valerie on this. It seems that Camille is experiencing, as Hazel so quaintly put it, the mother of all hissy fits.
All right, calm down, everyone. It's nothing much. Camille got turned down for another movie.
Nothing much. Whenever Camille gets rejected, she gets in one of her moods. What we're seeing now is just the tip of the iceberg. There's no way in heaven she can do a live performance now.
Hazel's right. She'll be biting everyone's heads off before we get to the first commercial break. And the way she's screaming, she's not going to have a voice left by the opening scene.
So what do you want me to do? I'm hardly the voice of authority when it comes to telling Camille what to do. The only person who could put on her short leash is Zach.
Not necessarily. I can think of one other person that might be able to calm her.
Who?
Oh, me? Oh, I don't think so. Let's just call Zach and get him back here.
Yeah. Come on, Lance. You're her boyfriend. Talk to her. She'll listen to you.
I wouldn't know what to say. She's practically hysterical.
Just make nice with her. You know, rub her shoulders, rub her feet, stick your tongue in her ear. Works for me.
I'll just call Zach. He'll straighten this out.
But we don't have time. We don't even know where he is right now, and we need to calm her down ASAP.
You don't have to do this, Lance.
Yes, I do. Without Camille, we're in serious trouble. I need to march in there and make her listen to reason.
Admirable, my boy, admirable indeed. Your dedication to the craft is to be commended, and you should be rewarded for your sacrifice.
Reward? What kind of reward?
I know.
We'll hoist one in your honor. Glasses up, everyone! Two lands.
I'm the condemned man here. Shouldn't I get a drink?
You'll need all your wits about you to deal with her. Besides, you know how much booze I now need to replenish?
Whatever.
There goes a brave, brave man. Stupid, but brave.
This one's empty. What's up with that?
Oh, I knew there was one around here that needed refilling. Be a dear and hand that lost lamb over to Annie Hazel, witch dear.
Sure, just as soon as you trade me for one with liquor. I'm a drink behind everyone else. Give that flask back to Hazel, Valerie, and leave it alone. You know you're too young to drink.
Pardon me.
I'm looking for Zach, man. I was told he'd be here.
He's not here right now. Can one of us help you?
I've got to get this letter to him. It's pretty broken, man.
You can give it to Miss Summers. She's his most trusted assistant. She'll see that it gets there.
Well, I do that, but, I mean, it's considered confidential.
It's private.
Honey, one thing we don't have any of in this studio is secrets.
Don't you believe it?
Whoa! Oh, no way! Are you Valerie Hayes?
Yeah.
Oh, dude, I saw that spray you did for the globe. Oh, you are so hot.
You really think so?
Yeah, I mean, you're like so hot, like even hotter than Jessica Alba. I mean, she's like, whoa, but you are like, oh.
Much better than an autograph. Honey.
The thought of those two together certainly paints a disturbing picture.
You're not kidding. Since when did she become such a little tramp?
Well, not that I'm defending her, but she is a teenager after all. Part of that you can blame on hormones. The rest? Well, this is Hollywood.
Oh, true words were never spoken. When I think of the things I did when I was her age...
Oh, please, spare us the sordid tales of your debaucherous youth.
Ease up a little, Jeffrey. Didn't you do some things that are scandalous in your days?
Certainly not. I was dedicated to perfecting my craft. My heart belonged to the stage, and my soul to the bard.
But what about your...
Hazel.
I was just curious.
If it will satisfy your lecherous quest for carnal lust, there may have been an escapade or two during my residency in London.
Details. Give us details.
Her name was Fiona. A flaxen-haired beauty with the most brilliant sapphire eyes. She was the understudy for Ophelia when we performed Hamlet at the Royal Theatre. The first time our eyes met, we knew there was an instant attraction. I was in the midst of an internship, and my studies allowed me to spend most of my time backstage. I was to study acting techniques, but I found all of my attention focused on the fair Fiona. Our relationship continued to grow until one day we met in the costume storage room together. In other words, needed said between us, for we were of one mind. We embraced and let our restrained passions erupt to the surface. Within moments, we were completely unclothed, reveling in the joy of physical bliss. I could restrain myself no longer and vocalize my jubilation with the mighty Leon Macduff, and damn be he that cries enough.
You have got to be kidding.
You didn't.
Shakespeare even then? Did I miss something?
Nothing, child, nothing.
I need a drink.
I need a cigarette.
Jeffrey was just telling us about a performance of Macbeth he did while he was in...
Fiona! London! You didn't get that message from the kid, did you?
Oh, ye little thing. And what act of depravity did you have to do to pull that off? Nothing that disgusting. Well, you played a little kissy face, and then I signed an autograph. On his butt.
What?
He didn't have any paper. His friend's gonna take a picture of it before it wears off.
Couldn't you have signed his shirt or something?
Well, he suggested signing his undies, but trust me, I was better off signing his butt.
All right, too much information. What about the message?
Let's wait until Zach reads it, and hopefully he'll tell us. It's an offer to have him direct the remake of The Wolfman.
Rick White? What?
I signed that guy's ass. That justifies me opening his letter.
All right, let's put this bombshell on the back burner. Do your final checks and stay backstage to the audience. Come on, let's go! We got a show to do! Get going!
Office, thank you.
Oh, Jeffrey, can you let Camille and Lance know that the show is about to start?
As you wish, Miss Summers.
Well, this certainly changes things, doesn't it?
Change doesn't even describe it. Once Zach reads this, he'll jump at it like a rabid pit bull. And then what will we do?
I have no idea. We've never had a backup director before. Nobody wants to touch a live performance.
It's a no-win situation. Zach's gonna take the offer whether the studio likes it or not. If they object, he'll still walk. And the show will be finished.
You know, there's still one option that you haven't considered. There's one person who could possibly fill Zach's shoes if he wants.
Who? The only person who knows the show was well enough is me.
My point exactly.
What? Me? Direct? I'm not a director. I'm not even registered for the guild.
But there's nothing to that. If the studio wants to keep the show going, they'll pay the cost to get you signed up. They can get you a card within a week. I've seen it happen.
The key words in that sentence are, if the studio wants to keep the show going.
They will. We may have slipped in the ratings a little bit, but we're still consistently in the top 20. You said it yourself. They're scrambling for mid-season replacement material. They can't afford to fill another time slot.
Say this all happens, there's just one little snag. Camille, she's never going to listen to me.
She will if you stand your ground. She's all bark and no bite. You stand your ground, she'll cave every time, I'm practically guaranteed.
Guarantee what, Max? What have I missed now?
Max was just telling us how the show will go off like clockwork and that the cast will perform like a well-oiled machine.
Lord, I hope so. I can't take one more thing going haywire. It's been such a strain to keep this show going lately, I'm about ready to pack it up and move home.
Zach, I would think twice before doing that. Opportunity may be knocking at your door sooner than you think.
What have you got? Crystal ball or something?
No. More like a direct Wi-Fi connection to Miss Cleo.
It's funny, Max. I'd laugh, but I'm just not in a good mood.
Can't blame the guy for trying.
Well, it's about time to start. We better get out of here.
I'm gonna head up to the booth. Let's give him a show.
You got it, boss. What were you thinking? You were going to tell him about the offer?
And why shouldn't I? Doesn't he deserve to hear some good news after the day he's had?
But we need him right now! I'll give it to him after the show. That way he can celebrate properly.
I guess you're right. We need him focused right now. And when he hears about this, he's not even going to remember Pryde and Joy exists. Besides, what could possibly happen in a half an hour?
Well, hello there. Oh, are you ready to get started?
Well, hello, Joey. Is it warm-up time already?
It is. Audience seated. They're looking a little restless, and it's time for me to earn my paycheck.
All right, Joey. Well, we'll get out of your way, let you do your thing. Just knock him dead.
Well, if I do that, you'll have to change the name of the show from Pryde and Joy to Pryde and Joey. Well, we all know what happened in the last show. I had the name Joey in the title, don't we?
Keep that up, you'll be taking my job.
Yes, that's what they tell me. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to Studio 14, home of the hit comedy Pryde and Joy. Now, as you know, you're here to watch a live performance, so we will be broadcasting to the Eastern, Central, and Mountain time zones. Then we're going to set it all up and do it all over again for our friends in the Pacific zone. Now, we pride ourselves, pardon the pun, I'm doing nothing but live shows, and we want to make sure that everyone gets to see our cast at their very best. So, because of that, I have some good news and some bad news. The bad news is we have some technical rules here that are very important, that we're very serious about, that I need you to pay attention to, and I need you to follow very thoroughly. The good news is I saved a lot of money by switching my insurance to Geico. Let me introduce myself. My name is Joey Blake, and I'm what's known as a warm-up guy. Everybody say, what up, Joey Blake?
What up, Joey Blake?
So first of all, I just said that, so let's move on. I have this chart of things to read here, and sometimes I get ahead of myself. But seriously, we need to make absolutely sure that your cell phones, beepers, other electronic devices are turned off. This is to keep from disrupting the actors and the scenes. You also need to relinquish any recording devices of any sort. Video cameras, photography, camera phones, and audio recorders are strictly prohibited. If you're caught recording here in the studio, we are going to have to confiscate your recording equipment and escort you out by some of our beefy security guards that we have in the back. We do encourage your laughter and applause, but we ask that you refrain from talking or making any other bodily noises during the scenes. And if I have to explain to you what a bodily noise is, everyone say this, the microphones are extremely sensitive, so I hope no one has had soda or beans before coming here. So everybody stand up, come on. You've been in these scenes for a while, stand up, get the kinks out a little bit. And before we get the kinks out a little bit, I don't like people sitting next to strangers. So if you look beside you or behind you and there's somebody you don't know, introduce yourself. And if you know everyone around you, give them a hug.
Thank you.
defend the love from up here. Defend the love. So I know you've been sitting in your seats for a while. You're probably a little stiff. So let me get everybody reach for the ceiling. Come on. There you go. Now, because you're friends with your neighbor now, go ahead and don't be afraid to put your hand in their face like this and stretch it out. Come on, do it. They're putting it in someone else's face. Go ahead and do it in the other direction now. All right, now, make your hands into fists and spin around. Okay, everybody, I need some audience participation on this. A little more than what you've done. I need everyone to turn to your left. Your other left. Yes, okay. Now, put your hands on the shoulders of the person in front of you. Just go ahead and step up. Doesn't matter if you don't know them or not. You're all going to be friends in the next 30 seconds or so. Are we all set?
Yeah.
Now give them a massage. It's nice, isn't it? DJ, hit it! Right. You know what's coming, right? Joke of all time. Do you guys want to hear it?
Yes!
Not up.
Who's there?
Daisy.
Daisy.
Daisy be rolling. Faded. You guys know you love that, right? Okay, one more thing. One more thing. We'll break it down and get ready for the show. I love magic tricks, but I'm not very good at them. As a matter of fact, I'm horrible at them. So you're getting ready to see the worst magic trick you've ever seen. I can't even take the cards out of the package, I'm so bad at this. So we're gonna come over here. Hold on, that guy's got a brand new start. Hi! What's your name?
Abby.
Hi, Abby. Hi. My name's Joey Blake. All right, hold on. I'm gonna shut. Hold this for a minute. Frederick, you not sing song. No? No songs? You can sing about what I am! Okay. Worst card trick ever. You ready? Pick the top four. Alright, you got it? You can look at it and show everybody the card. Okay, everybody see it?
Yep.
We good? All right, hold this up. I didn't sure figure out which card I did. No, I'm kidding. Put it back in. All right, you'll cut the deck. Awesome. You, pick a card. Pick the top one. You
You ready? Is that your card right there?
No.
Okay, go back into the middle where you were before. Let's do it your way. Is that your card right there?
No.
We have 50 more times to do this till we get it right. I'm kidding. You guys have been a great, great crowd. Are you ready?
Ready.
Are you ready for Pryde and Joy? Are you ready? Please have a seat. I told you that was the worst card trick in the world. I wasn't kidding. Now that we've all gotten to know each other, it's time to introduce you to our cast. First of all, playing the lovable next door neighbor, Ruth Polanski is one of Hollywood's legends of movie and TV, Hazel Cadwallader. Next is the lovable husband, Mitchell Polanski, another legend of stage and screen, Jeffrey Dinsmore. And now, the adorable daughter of Alan and Joy is Katie Pryde, Valerie Headings. Yay! Here's the lovable father and dashing husband of our show, as Alan Pryde, Lance Burroughs. Finally, one of America's sweethearts and one of TV Guide's top 10 sitcom moms for Joy Pryde, please give it up for Camille Fairchild.
All for coming out here to see us today. We hope that you have as much fun watching us as we do performing for you. So why don't you sit back, relax, and we'll get started in just a couple minutes.
All right, fantastic. Okay, folks, we're going to go to a blackout. Then when you hear the theme music playing, we will be on the air. Thanks again for coming. Lance, don't run off just yet. Hey, check your pockets for me. You're inside jacket pockets. Oh, fantastic. Here, you need this.
What's it say on the outside?
Lance Burroughs, read to audience upon receipt.
I wonder what it is.
Hi, Lance. Tell them it's the Nine of Diamonds. Thanks, Joey.
Want your card?
Places. And we're live. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, action.
And they were laughing. Can you believe it? Well, personally, I think it's almost scandalous. She is the vice president of the PTA. She cannot have afford to have her image taken. Well, no, I didn't see it myself, but I got it from a very reliable source. Well, it was Phoebe who told me while we were in line at the IGA. I agree. Grace told her. Who else? You know how close those two are. Yes, Grace tends to get her facts confused at times. But Phoebe said that Dharma told her that Grace got it from Elaine. And you know how accurate she is. Well, regardless if it's true or not, it's enough to give me chills. I won't even let Katie go anywhere near Wisteria Lane now. It's just too dangerous. Oh, speaking of Katie, She's coming up the walk now. I better go. It was nice talking with you too, Fran.
Hello, Mother. I've got a lot of homework, so I'm going to be in my room all night.
Catherine Marie Pryde. You march yourself right back down here at once, young lady. Is that any way to greet your mother?
I'm sorry. I was just in a hurry.
I can see that, but that is no excuse for being rude.
Yes, Mother, I won't do it again.
That's better. Now, how was school today?
School was just peachy, but I've really got a lot of homework to do, so I'm going to get started.
Hold it! What is going on here? If there is one thing I know, it's that you have never been anxious to do homework. What are you trying to hide?
I'm not trying to hide anything.
Don't you try to lie to me, Katie. You know you get the hiccups whenever you tell a lie.
Don't be silly. I don't do anything. I that.
You were saying? Watch your mouth! A lady does not use such harsh language!
Yes, Mother. I'm sorry.
Now, I didn't get a call from your school today, and it's too early for report cards. So, that can only mean one thing. Homework, am I right?
Yes.
I thought as much. Go upstairs and put your things away. We will get Father to help when he gets home.
It's not exactly something Daddy can help me with.
What? Oh, your father is the smartest man that I have ever known. There has never been a problem he couldn't solve.
But can he cook?
I beg your pardon?
I have to give a presentation tomorrow on my home ec class on how to bake a cake. I know I should have practiced by now, but without anyone to show me how it's done, I never got around to it. And now Miss McGregor is going to give me an F.
Oh, honey, we don't need your father for this. I can show you how to make a cake. Oh, this is going to be so much fun. We'll get started tonight, right after dinner.
Get started with what?
Oh, hello, Ruth. Katie and I are going to make a cake tonight after dinner for her home ec class tomorrow. It's going to be a real mother-daughter experience that she will never forget.
You can say that again.
That sounds positively lovely. I wish I could have done something like that with my children.
Oh, well, Ruth, you had three boys. None of them are very interested in cooking.
They were when dinner time came around. They'd want to know what we were having. By the time I told them, they'd already devoured it. It's a wonder that Mitchell and I didn't starve to death back then.
I bet. Oh, but anyway, I think Katie and I will make a scrumptious orange cake. That'll be easy enough to demonstrate to a class.
Oh, Joy, I make a chocolate cake that just melts in your mouth. In fact, when I make it, I have to hide it from Mitchell so he won't eat it all in one evening.
I'm sure it's delicious, Ruth, but I don't think it's wise to be feeding chocolate to a bunch of teenagers during school. And besides, chocolate should be saved for special occasions.
But this is a special occasion. This is Katie's first cake.
Actually, I have a recipe here in my textbook.
Recipe?
I'm sorry, did I say something funny?
Oh, honey, you never use the recipes when cooking. Real cooks keep their recipes up here.
Your mother's right, sweetheart. The best cooks tweak their food as they cook.
I can see this isn't going to go well.
Oh, what was that, honey?
I said this is going to go swell.
Was that a hiccup, Katie?
I'm home. Where are my two favorite girls?
Hi, Daddy. I'm so happy to see you.
And how's my precious angel today?
Fine, now that you're here.
Uh-oh. I know that tone. You want something. Well, we'll talk about it in a little bit. Let me give the most beautiful woman in the world a hello kiss first.
Well, normally, I don't let anybody kiss me but my husband. But in your case, I'll make an exception.
It's good to see you too, Ruth, but you'll have to forgive me. I wouldn't want to make Mitch jealous.
Please, make him jealous. It'd be nice to hear him say something besides he's tired and hungry.
How was your day, darling?
Much better now. The best part about going to work is coming home to my beautiful wife and daughter.
Oh, Alan, you always say the sweetest things.
Isn't that the truth? Alan, could you give Mitchell some lessons on how to talk to his wife?
You mean Mitch doesn't pay you any compliments?
Heavens no. He says the same things every day.
What type of thing, Ruth? Why? I'm hungry. Where's my dinner?
Wow, Mrs. B, you sound just like your husband.
What is going on in here?
Oh, Mitchell, I'm sorry. I didn't know it was so late. I'll go home and get dinner started.
Started? When you know it's Wednesday, I go bowling every Wednesday night. I don't have time now to wait around for you to fix a meal.
I can fix you a nice sandwich and a salad. You have plenty of time to eat that.
A sandwich? A salad? Do I look like a bunny rabbit to you? I'm a man, I need meat!
Well, I'll see if I can hunt and kill something between here and our house next door. If not, you'll just have to do. Joy, I'll be back after dinner to help you and Katie with that cake.
I'll be there in a minute. I gotta talk to Alan.
What's up, Mitch? Is everything okay?
Okay, you heard her. She said she's gonna hunt and kill something between here and our house. Elmer Fudd hunts better than her. Honestly, she can't kill nothing but the mood.
I think it was a figure of speech.
What'd you say about her figure?
But really, Alan, we're in a bit of a bind. Old Spanky McFarley called. Well, he can't make it to bowling tonight. He was out shooting pool this afternoon with Smiley Burdett, and, well, you know, he's got that wooden eye. Well, Smiley made it 50 cents that he wouldn't take it out and put a pool ball in there. Yeah, he done it. He put that six ball in there, and it got stuck. Yeah, sometimes it's six, and sometimes it's nine. And sometimes it's, But anyway, we're hoping you can take his spot. He's got to go see the doctor.
Whoa, gosh, this is sort of last minute. I haven't even spent any time with Joy and Katie tonight.
Oh, that's all right, Alan. Katie and I are going to work on some homework tonight.
Homework? You?
Mother's going to teach me how to bake a cake.
Cake? What kind of cake are you baking? Ruth makes this chocolate cake. It tastes like dirt. She makes the darn thing, I gotta bag it up and throw it away. In your trash can.
Let's make the raccoons. Well, Mitch, since this is gonna be a pitching exercise, I guess I'm free after all.
All right, great. I'll be back in an hour to pick you up.
Joy, are you sure about this?
Of course, Alan. You go out with Mitch and have a good time.
No, I mean, teaching Katie to bake?
Alan, you always get to help Katie with her homework. You help her with history, math, English, and science. For once, I get to teach her something important. And I want to make the most out of this opportunity.
Well, I guess I can't argue with an argument like that. It's settled then. After dinner, I'll leave you two girls alone to have some quality time together. How does that sound to you, Pumpkin?
I'm sure me and Mother are going to have the most wonderful time together tonight.
I am so excited. This is going to be so much fun.
Okay, people. Places, everyone. We got 3 minutes. 3 minutes.
Thank you.
update on the spotlight investigations?
I'm so sorry, Miss Fairchild. I tried so hard to stop her, but she insisted that she needed to see me right away. I turned around for 1 second to call for security, and the next thing I knew, she was on the set.
So I see. Miss Applegate, Pleasant, you might not be aware of this, but this is not a convenient time for me. We're in the middle of a live television broadcast.
I understand that, Miss Fairchild, but your instructions are very clear. It's to bring you the results of the investigation.
Just as soon as they were complete. No matter when, no matter where.
No exceptions.
Do you always take everything you're told so literally?
You want to tell Business Suit Barbie here to back off before she gets hurt?
It's okay, Gwen. She's right. This is important. Okay, let me have it. What did you find out about Lance Burroughs?
The report's in this envelope. But I really think we should sit down and go over it together.
Sweetie, I don't have time for that right now. Just give me the envelope. I'll look over the first chance I get, and if I have any questions, I'll be in touch.
I really think we should go over it together.
Honey, in about 90 seconds, we're going on live to most of the country. The American public sees you on their television broadcast. All hell is going to break loose. Just follow my assistant, Gwen, back to my trailer. She'll make sure you get paid. Thanks for all your hard work. Right now, I really need you to scram.
Okay, lady. Whatever you say. Good luck.
Don't you know you never wish someone in show business good luck?
I am not talking about the show, sister. That's the last thing you're gonna need luck with, is Susan Lucci wannabe.
You need to go right now. Gwen? We'll discuss this breach after the show, but if I were you, I would start updating my resume.
Yes, Miss Fairchild.
Places. We're back in 5, 4, 3. 2, 1, action.
All right, sweetie, let's go ahead and get started. The first thing we'll need to do is combine our flour, baking powder, and salt into a bowl.
Flour, baking powder, salt. How much of each?
How much flour was that, Joy? 2 cups?
I'd say closer to 3.
3? Oh, I never use that much flour. I think it makes a cake heavy.
Oh, well, Alan likes a heavy cake. He doesn't eat so much in one sitting.
So what now?
Well, once you have that mixed, you can go ahead and add 3 eggs.
3 eggs? Oh, Joy, aren't you worried about calories?
I'm more worried about making a cake that looks good and tastes even better. If we were meant to worry about calories, God would not have created desserts.
So true, so true. 3 eggs, check. What next?
Now we can go ahead and add sugar. I wonder who that could be.
Do you want me to go get it?
No, dear. I do not want you answering the door at this time of night. It's almost 7:15. You never know who's out and about these days. I'll get it.
Katie, would you hand me that bowl over there, please?
Sure, Mrs. Blinsky, but why?
I'm gonna show you how to make a chocolate cake.
Chocolate cake? But I thought we were making an orange cake.
You know, Katie, I think the world of your mother. She's the best friend I've ever had. But I've tasted her orange cake. And it's all right. But if you want to earn an A in your home ec class, you'll follow my recipe. Now, write this down. 2 and a smidgen cups of flour.
How much is a smidgen?
More than a pinch, but less than a dab.
Right, that makes it clear as mud.
2 teaspoons of baking soda. Some salt.
How much salt?
More than a pinch, but less than a smidgen.
Between a pinch and a smidgen, that makes a pigeon? Ew, I'm not making a pigeon for my home ec class.
Pigeons? Who said anything about pigeons? Katie, we were talking about adding salt.
But why do you add salt to a cake in the first place? I thought cakes were supposed to be sweet.
Well, that's not really a question I can answer. Katie, if you just add it because you're taught to, it's like adding sugar to chili. You don't know why you do it, you just do it. My mother taught me to add salt to a cake mix, and I'm sure her mother taught her.
I may never eat cakes again. I'm almost afraid to see what you use in pie.
Well, that depends on the pie, Katie. An apple, you add nutmeg. A cherry pie.
I think I get the idea.
Katie, I think I'm going to need the sifter. This is lumpier than it should be.
I knew we should have used a recipe.
Did I hear something about pigeons?
Oh, we were just talking about how many pigeons had been in the neighborhood lately. We need to get more cats. Who's at the door?
Oh, a church group selling peanut butter cookies to raise funds for a mission trip to Chile. Isn't that sweet?
Baking soda, salt, nutmeg, peanut butter, chili.
Where is Chile? Isn't that just outside of Poughkeepsie?
Oh, no, silly. It's not even in New Jersey. I think it's in Australia somewhere.
Australia? Ooh, cracky! That's a long way to go on a mission trip. They're going to have to sell a lot of peanut butter cookies.
Oh, blimey! Well, they were also selling coconut cookies and lemon cookies, but they have run out of all those. I forget. Have we added the sugar yet to the recipe?
Sugar, coconut, lemon. Lemon? Why are we adding lemon? I thought this was an orange cake.
Oh, it is, sweetie. Haven't you been taking notes?
I have, but I think I got confused somewhere. When did we add chili?
Chili? Katie, what are you talking about? Good heavens, again? You think you're having a party or something.
Do you want me to get it this time, Joy?
Oh, no. You stay here. See if you can help Katie get her notes straightened out.
Sure thing. Okay, Katie, write this down. 3 squares of chocolate, 1/2 cup of buttermilk.
Here we go again. Chocolate, buttermilk.
Oh, I added too much milk. Nuts.
Milk, nuts. Nuts? Why are we adding nuts if we already added peanut butter?
Peanut butter? When did we add peanut butter? I don't even know the recipe for peanut butter cake.
Peanut butter cake? But I thought we were making a chocolate cake. Oh, I'm so confused. I need a glass of water.
Oh, Katie, what are you doing? I need that water for my recipe.
I'm sorry. Nobody told me it was for the recipe, so I thought it was for drinking.
That's okay, dear. Can you get me some more from the refrigerator, please?
Mrs. P, Mom must have not refilled the pitcher after dinner. Can we put something else in its place?
Well, that depends. What have you got?
I see milk, lemonade, apple juice, orange juice, and a bottle of Yoo-Hoo.
Yoo-Hoo? That's perfect! It's a chocolate cake. It'll blend right in. Nobody will know the difference.
Is this what you call tweaking the recipe?
This is tweaking at its finest, sweetheart. Now, be a good girl and hand me 2 eggs.
2 eggs. Got it.
Have we figured out the problem with the recipe yet?
I think so. It's nothing a bottle of Yoo-Hoo couldn't fix.
That's nice. You?
Who was it this time?
I'm sorry, what?
Who was at the door?
Oh, it was the paper boy. I hadn't realized he hadn't been paid yet for the week. Alan usually takes care of all the bills and such. It's not like him to forget something so important.
Paying the paper boy is important?
Excuse me?
I asked if paying the paper boy was important.
Oh, of course. It's relevant to keep a good standing in the community. If you forget something like paying the paper boy, word gets around and people will talk.
Well, I'd love to hear what they say if you forget to pay the electric bill. Imagine the scandal that would cause.
I'm sorry, something like what?
Not paying the electric bill, Mother. Are you all right?
Quite all right, Katie. Why wouldn't I be?
You seem a little distracted. Why don't you help us with this cake recipe?
I'm sorry, I guess my mind is a little preoccupied with something else.
That's obvious. But we're supposed to be helping Katie, remember? She has her cake baking presentation for school tomorrow.
I know. It's something she should have been working on a long time ago. But just like her darling father, she has spent her time screwing around.
What did you say?
Message.
Well, this is interesting. Since you all apparently already know about this, I'm sure you can guess what my answer is going to be. But until then, since I'm still the director of this soon-to-be-canceled series, the first thing I need to say is, Peyton, you're fired.
What? What did I do?
From everything I've seen and everything Camille's been saying in the last 3 minutes, you've undermined the trust placed upon you by everyone involved in this show, especially me. I have no idea what your motives are behind it, but it ends right here, right now.
Way to go, Zach! Make sure that hussy never works in this town again.
It's not what you think. Whatever you think it is, I'm not trying to undermine the cast or anything. I was not even the one that opened the envelope.
She speaks the truth about that, Zachary. The information was... it was revealed by source, which I should prefer to remain nameless.
He's right, Zach. Peyton found out when the rest of us did. It was too close to the start of the show. If she would have told you, you wouldn't have been able to keep your mind on us.
Don't listen to them, Zach! They're all smitten by her. She's probably fooling around with them, too!
I've had enough of your mouth. I'm gonna finish what I started before the show.
Wait for me, Hazel. I want a shot at her, too.
Either one of you touch me!
Shut up! You know, if I thought I could get away with it, I'd fire you two. But I know I can't. So the next best thing I can do is quit. As far as I'm concerned, Pryde and Joy no longer exists.
What are you saying?
I've said enough! I have seen and heard more than enough of your bickering. The eight of you together are undoubtedly the most uncooperative and hostile group I have ever had the misfortune of observing. I can see this situation is not going to resolve on its own, so the matter is no longer in any of your hands. For the time being, Mr. McMahon, your resignation is not accepted. And Ms. Summers, you are not fired. If there are to be any dismissals or reprimands, they will come from the studio executives where they belong. It is the studio's sole discretion as to the fate of Pryde and Joy, and we will be discussing this issue in length immediately. Mr. McMahon, Mr. Bodenstein, please report to the executive boardroom right away. As for the rest of you, there will be cars waiting to take each one of you to your own homes. You will report back tomorrow at this soundstage at noon. A decision regarding this show, as well as your careers, will have been determined by then. Have I made myself clear?
Can I ask just one small
question? Say good night, Miss Fairchild.
Good night, Miss Fairchild.
Will you speak of all victories and cherished moments together, or will you whisper of the treachery and maliciousness that led to our inevitable downfall? What will be our place in history? Will the scribes rank us with such names as I Love Lucy and The Honeymoon Is Over? Shall we be condemned to dwell in the depths with such atrocities as married with children and Jody loves Chachi?
Bravo! Bravo, Jeffrey! If Shakespeare were alive today, he himself couldn't have said it any better.
Have pity, what an old fool, my boy. Seems only fitting that I should give a fun so little to me to an empty house to mark the dismal ending of what should have been an illustrious career.
What dismal ending? You're nowhere near finished. You're at the age where you can do things other actors can only imagine.
Your kindness is appreciated, but but we both know that after the final tracer drops on Pryde and Joy, it will be rather difficult for any of us to achieve gainful employment in our chosen profession.
Assuming that your prophecy of doom is even slightly accurate, do you have any plans for the future?
I've considered offering my services to any of the educational institutions in the area, provided they still believe that Shakespearean training is worth passing along to future generations.
Well, good for you. I'm glad to see your plan was staying active. I hate to see talents such as yours go to waste.
You are too kind. There are many of those who believe that I'm antiquated and ready to be put out of posture. Enough lamentation over my own fading career. What about you, Lancelot? Do you have any plans after we've been released from our contract to the studio?
That's a good question. Like you said, once the series is canned, none of us will be too high on any studio's call list.
To tell you the truth, I've seriously considered about going back to stage. I think it would be nice to get back to my roots and do live performing the way it's supposed to be done. In front of the audience, but not for cameras.
Oh, splendid. Well done. Well done. And, if I may ask, of your relationship with Miss Summers?
I don't know. We haven't talked about it. I tried to call Peyton all night, but all I got was a voicemail. I know it'd do me a little good to stay in Hollywood right now, but
Peyton's different. This is really the only place she can find steady work.
I guess we'll find out soon enough.
Hello, anyone else out here?
In here, Valerie. Me and Jeffrey are on set.
Hey guys, have either of you been watching TV lately?
I haven't bothered to turn the infernal thing on.
Me either. I can only imagine what they're saying about us.
Boy, you've missed out. We're off everywhere. All anyone can talk about is Pryde and Joy.
And who, pray tell, is it?
Oh, let's see. Leno, Letterman, Good Morning America, Entertainment Tonight, Yahoo! Camille's televised breakdown is the biggest thing since Janet Jackson flashed her tatas on the Super Bowl.
That's odd. If everyone's making such a fuss about this, why hasn't anyone tried to contact us to find out more about it?
Because you've all been placed on a gag order. That's why. Anytime someone's tried contacting the studio, the publicity department has issued a steady stream. No comments. Anyone tries to contact Cass, Peyton, or Zach, they're giving out no contact information. There are to be no leaks to the media until the final decisions have been made.
That's a bummer. We finally get publicity for something as a group, and we can't even talk about it?
I'm sure it's for the best, child. That way there's only one story that's given instead of eight conflicting stories.
What about Camille? I'm sure she's ready to start shouting from the rooftops.
Someone from the publicity department stayed with her last night and said that she wouldn't. But she's the one we have to worry about the most. For half a chance, she'll be singing an aria about how we all conspired against her to ruin her career.
Fat chance of that happening. From what I've seen on the replays, she's committed career suicide. And I can't see how she can spin her way out of it. The only problem is she's taking all of us down with her by guilt by association.
Hey, are you feeling okay? There's something different about you.
Yeah, Max is right, Hazel. You're acting more coherent than usual.
How kind of you to notice. In fact, there is something different. For the record, I'm stone cold sober. Really, you.
What has caused this drastic change in your behavior?
This whole fiasco. When I got home last night, I turned on the TV and watched our big meltdown. You'd be surprised at just how much was broadcast. I watched it over and over and heard what the media had to say about it and us. and I found every bottle I had squirreled away and poured it all down the sink. For the first time in at least 3 years, I woke up without a headache and early enough to get properly groomed and actually eat a decent meal.
Okay, I give up. Why?
On the off chance that I can still land a role somewhere. I'm not ready to hang it up yet, and I don't plan on going to an audition drunk as much as I'd like to. I hate auditions. I always have.
Agreed. Plus, it's so long since any of us have had to audition for anything. It's probably a whole new process.
So, Mr. Bodenstein, how long before any of us have to start hitting the pavement, I believe the expression goes?
You mean pounding the pavement, Jeffrey, and I'm not at liberty to divulge any information until Zach gets here.
That won't be very long. I passed him walking this way.
How are you? I tried to get a hold of you all night, but I couldn't get through.
I shut off my cell phone when I got in the car. I need to think about everything that's happened and where my life is going. I love you, Lance, but I don't think I can afford to have a relationship right now.
We really need to talk about this.
Yes, we do. I need to know what's most important for me, for you, and us.
I've been doing some thinking about that, and I might have a solution. How would you feel about going to New York City?
New York City? Why would you want to go there?
I was thinking I could try to get back on stage. I could try to get a part on Broadway, and you could take some time off just to relax.
And just what would we live on if you find a part? I mean, if they'll give you a part.
I've got a decent amount of money saved up. Plus, I could sell my house. With what I could get for it, we would be comfortable for a while.
Sell your house? You want to make this a permanent move?
I thought this would be a good chance to try something new and get away from all the craziness here in L.A.
And trade it all for the craziness in New York? Have you been there, Lance? It's just like Hollywood, only in more compact space.
But I just thought that...
That's the problem! You're doing the thinking for both of us. I really would have appreciated sitting down and discussing this. But, and we haven't spent enough quality time together. Has the potential of working great for you. But what about me?
Well, excuse me for trying to think about a future together. I just thought this would be a good chance to make a clean break and make a fresh start as a real couple. I just never knew you were that much more committed to your career than you are to a relationship.
That's not fair. You never give me a chance to speak my feelings on the subject.
I tried to call you all night. You're the one who shut your phone off as soon as you left the studio. Maybe I should forget about the whole thing and go off to New York alone.
Hold that thought, Lance. You may want to reconsider after hearing what I've got to say. All right, everybody, gather around. I've got a lot to go over.
Forgive me for saying this, Zach, but you look like hell. Did you or Max get any sleep last night at all?
As a matter of fact, no. We've been up all night going over with the studio execs where we're going to take the show.
You and Max both? Oh, this can't be good.
That depends on how you look at it.
Don't leave us in suspense. Obviously, something has been decided.
You didn't tell them?
Didn't say a word. Waited for you just like we agreed.
Wait, we can't start. Camille isn't here.
Camille won't be joining us.
What?
Initially, the studio's decision was to pull Pryde and Joy off the air immediately. They didn't think there was any way we could recover from that embarrassment. Once the ratings came in, everybody's mood began to change.
What are you talking about?
Apparently, we were on the air just long enough for everybody to call their friends and have them switch over to see everything go to hell. Our ratings went from an 8.3 to a 13.2 almost instantly. You guys know we haven't been anywhere near a 13 in years. Even after the network cut the feed and it was just commercial after commercial, people stayed tuned in, just hoping to see one more thing before the end of the show.
This is a good thing.
As a matter of fact, Jeffrey, it is. We got all the commercials on the air, so there's no legal repercussions from advertisers. And in case you guys haven't been paying attention, we're pretty much all that Hollywood's talking about right now.
I told you, we are so hot.
That's all well and good, Zach, but what's gonna happen to us?
Well, it depends. The studio's still willing to take a chance on Pryde and Joy, but there's going to have to be some changes.
Changes? What kind of changes?
First, we're going to go from live to pre-recorded. Last night's glitch was enough to convince the studio that even after 8 seasons, live television's just too risky. They don't want to risk a repeat of that.
What else?
Well, second, I'm going to step down as director.
No, Zachary.
I think you can all plainly see that I'm burnt out and just not able to carry on for another week. I'll stay on as technical director and creative consultant, but I'm going to take the offer from Universal, and the studio's agreed that that's probably a good move for me.
Wait a minute. You're saying you're taking a break from us by going to work?
Yes, that's one way to put it.
That's just stupid. People say teenagers don't make any sense.
Who did they have in mind as a replacement director?
Well, we talked about a few names, but the obvious choice, if she wants the job, is Peyton.
What? Are you kidding me?
Peyton, you've been here just as long as either of us, and you know the show just as well as us.
But I'm not even registered for the guild, and I don't have enough money to pay the dues.
Peyton, the studio will cover your dues. They'll take a little bit out of each one of your paychecks to cover it, but you'll still see a considerable pay increase.
I don't know.
Oh, Miss Summers, how can you refuse such an offer? It's very seldom that someone in Hollywood gets a proposition like this handed to them on a silver platter.
Shakespeare's right, dear. Opportunity's knocking, and you won't get another chance like this. Not in this town.
Zach, back me up on this. You're the head writer. You know, you've written situations for Joy Pryde for years.
Peyton, I need to apologize to you. Once Max explained everything that happened last night, I saw that you weren't trying to sabotage me or the show. You were just trying to keep things running as smooth as possible. Honestly, I can't think of anybody better to take the director's spot than me. I've been ready to take the next step for a long time. I'm just too obsessed with writing things to see.
Honey, this is fabulous. We can keep our careers and our relationship. If you want to, that is.
Of course I do. I would do anything to keep us together.
Then why did you make such a fuss about going to New York?
Because I would have liked to have been asked about it first, then it being decided for me. If it comes right down to it, I'd go anywhere with you.
Really? That's fantastic. I'm speechless. I don't know what to say.
Then shut up and kiss her, you fool.
Well, you heard the lady. Shut up and kiss me.
I hate to break up this happy moment, but there's just one small problem.
What's that, Valerie?
Camille. She's never going to agree to any of this. She'll never agree to Peyton as the director.
She's right. When Camille's never going to accept this. She'll have a full-grown cow when she hears this.
Well, Zach, should we tell her?
Well, we might as well. They're going to find out soon anyway.
Find out what?
Camille is no longer a part of the show.
No, you're kidding. What?
That's what's kept Max and I up all night. We've had to rewrite the next few episodes to explain and compensate for Camille's disappearance. We decided the best thing to do would be to kill her off and write somebody in as a replacement.
You can't be serious.
We're dead serious. Pardon the pun.
So, who are you going to put in Camille's place?
Well, I think we've got it whittled down to Jenna Elfman, Brooke Shields, Deborah Messing, and Heather Locklear.
Wait, you're telling me that I'm going to be married to Heather Locklear?
If you're lucky.
I like the sound of this idea already. Ow.
Don't get too comfortable with ideas, sweetheart. I don't think this is a wise decision.
It's not your call, Peyton. The studio wants her gone. Her antics have brought nothing but problems to this set for years. Last night was just the final straw.
But despite all her aggravation, she's still the biggest reason that people tune into the show.
Really? What are we then, chopped liver?
Compared to Camille, yes.
All of a sudden, I'm not so sure having a new director is such a good idea.
Come on, Max, back me up on this.
Hey, honey. Think about what you're saying.
I am! I swear, I'm not trying to belittle everyone. It's just that Joy Pryde, Camille does the comedy for the show, and she does it very well.
So what? What if the rest of us want a chance to spread our comedic limbs? Maybe I want to try some physical comedy.
I'm inclined to agree with young Valerie, and it's time for the rest of us to have our moments in the spotlight.
Peyton, stop trying to fight it. Look, we didn't like the idea at first either, but honestly, the more we discussed it, we found so much more we could do with the show without it.
What do you mean, so much more we can do with the show?
What he means is we can finally turn this show into the ensemble cast show it was always meant to be. I have some ideas that will highlight each one of you as individual characters, instead of the audience just seeing you as a supporting cast.
Do you plan to highlight this in a positive manner, or will this be more of the infantile style of comedy that you've subjected us to time and again?
Jeffrey, what I have in mind will be a blessing for the both of us. I've always wanted to do serious work, so I'll have the chance. I'll write you a role that will draw on every ounce of the Shakespearean training within you.
Do not jest with me, sir. My constitution cannot handle another shock, such as what we endured yesterday.
What about me? You're not planning to keep me the sweet and innocent child through all this, are you?
Valerie, I promise. Most of us will have to deal with Joy's death in ways we never imagined.
We're going to turn this show from a 50s sitcom into a 21st century dramedy, like some of the other shows out there.
Max, you're like a child in a toy store. You can't wait to get started on this little project, can you?
More than you know, Hazel. It's like a dream come true for me.
Well, if you're already scheming plot lines, what might you have in store for me?
Well, actually, you, my dear, are really the easiest one of the group. So, the character of Ruth is going to turn to the bottle for confidence. And she's going to develop a little bit of a drinking problem. And so...
You son of a bitch!
Well, what got into her? I thought she'll love that idea.
I'm sure she will, Max. I'm just guessing she probably would have wanted to hear this before dumping a couple hundred bucks worth of booze down the drain last night.
What?
It's true, she told us herself.
Oh, you know, I thought there was something wrong with her. It's been so long since I've seen her sober, I just thought she was sick.
Hello? Is this the Hollywood and Vine wine cellar? Do you deliver bulk orders?
And thus ends the great journey into perpetual sobriety.
And just what is so funny, young lady?
I'm just thinking about all the alcohol Hazel must have poured down the drain. There have got to be some pretty happy fish in the bay right now. Oh, they could get caught by some fishermen and not even give a rat's ass.
You know, I've heard of beer better than fish, but can you imagine someone trying to fry a Scotch show carp? I mean, that thing will explode as soon as it hits the frying pan.
Good one, Maxwell.
Miss Summers, is everything all right? You haven't even made so much as a smug.
No, Jeffrey, it's not all right. I hate to do this to you, Zach, but I have to turn down that director job.
What? Summers, no!
Are you serious? Why?
You said that no one else knows the characters in the show as well as you and Max and the rest of the cast except for me. But now you're talking about taking the characters and the show in a completely different direction than what we've done from the start? Yes, I know the characters, but I know the characters that make people laugh. What you're talking about is taking Pryde and Joy and turning it into the OC, and I can't direct a show like that.
But honey, think of the possibilities.
I am, that's the problem. for the audience, and it's two Jurassic chains for us.
So what do we do?
Well, if the studio is dead set on getting rid of Camille, we can't do anything about that. But is it necessary to kill her off? Couldn't we write around her character or something and put the comedy on the rest of the cast?
Think about what you're saying. You're condemning us back to the same pattern we've been stuck in.
And she's right. Even if I were drunk, which I plan on being very soon, I'd have to agree with Peyton. You just can't take a formula like ours and change it in such a drastic manner and expect the audience to accept it. It'd be like making Roseanne the mother of the Waltons.
I can't go back to the execs now and beg them to keep Camille. I'm sure they've told her already anyway. And even if they hadn't, they're not going to want to touch her with a stick. Well, maybe if they can hit her with a stick.
So we're damned if we do and damned if we don't.
I'm sorry, everyone. I'm trying not to spoil everything, but I'm trying to be practical about the situation. I mean...
Plus, Zach, it's not really your problem anymore, is it? You're going to the movies! How great is that?
Oh, the silver screen. So many memories made in front of the camera and behind the scenes. I remember this one movie I made with Ernie Borgnine, and we snuck off set.
I already had breakfast. I don't need it to brunch.
Back to the point of the conversation before we were so crudely interrupted. What is the name of the motion picture that you will be directing, Zach?
The Wolfman.
And just what is, as you call it, a Wolfman?
Wait, you don't know what the Wolfman is?
Miss Hennings, as you know, I spend very little of my time acclimating myself to what the general public refers to as a popular culture.
But it's the Wolfman. Does this mean you haven't heard of Frankenstein or Dracula either?
Of course I've heard of Count Dracula, of Transylvania, and Frankenstein's monster. They are two of the most recognized characters in all of literature. I vividly recall reading their stories in my youth.
Stories? Somebody wrote books about them?
Of course they did. Where do you think the ideas for the movies came from?
I don't know, it felt like video games, like Nintendo or something. I did not expect it to be books. Who wrote the books for Freddy Krueger and Jason?
Don't look at me, she's your daughter.
Yeah, but you write her dialogue!
This time I don't. As far as I'm concerned, she's gone completely improv.
Anyway, back to the Wolfman. Any ideas for casting?
Don't get your hopes up, it's none of you jokers. I've been thinking about Matt Damon. Kiefer Sutherland's pretty hot right now. The one I'm really looking forward to talk to on this one.
All right, where is she? Where's Camille?
Whoa, Eric, what's going on?
I need to find Camille. My phone's been ringing off the hook.
But you're not her agent anymore.
You know that, I know that, and Camille knows that. But nobody else does. I've got studios and directors calling me non-stop, wanting her to audition for parts, for movies.
What did you say?
It's the damnedest thing. I had no idea what was going on here after I left, until I got back to my place. I had Pryde and Joy DVR'd, so I watched it to see how she held up during the show. When she went into her meltdown, I thought I was going to die. I never laughed so hard in my life. First thing this morning, I call into my office, and my voicemail is loaded with messages from casting agents, movie studios, and A-list directors. Apparently, everyone important in Hollywood must have watched Camille's tirade and decided that she can act after all.
Wait, so people are actually calling and wanting her to audition for parts?
Not just audition. They want to sign her to contracts. I've had calls from Warner Brothers, Paramount, Columbia, Disney, DreamWorks. Miramax wants to talk to her again about the Jackie Onassis movie. Not only that, Universal wants her to do a screen test for some reboot they're doing of the Wolfman. Can you believe that?
What
did
I do to deserve this?
Do you all know what this means?
Yes. It means if you want to make a monster movie, you have to hire a real monster.
Besides that, do you know what will happen if Camille becomes a movie star?
I'm afraid so.
Unfortunately, I think I do.
Then someone explain it to me. What's so bad if Camille finally gets taken seriously for the movies?
It means if she becomes a movie star and the movie is a hit, then she's on track to become the next Julia Roberts or Nicole Kidman. And if that happens, she can find a way to put us all in the unemployment line for holding her back.
You really think she can do that?
I've seen it happen several times, dearie. Katharine Hepburn and Betty Davis both had a substantial amount of influence in this town at one time. If they didn't like you, you didn't get a job anyway.
So now what do we do?
Damage control. That's it, damage control. Max, Eric, come with me. Let's see if we can get Camille on fire. The rest of you, just get ready to kiss some serious ass, if it's not too late.
Oh, it's way too late for that, boys and girls. All of you combined don't have enough puppet power to save your skin.
Well, don't you look like the cat that swallowed the canary.
Canary hell, she looks like she downed the whole of you.
Do you know what the wonderful thing is about having an assistant? Even though I wasn't able to talk with anyone directly, due to being put under house arrest by the studio, my trusted, personal assistant Gwen was able to intercept all of the calls and relay them to me. So I know all about the offers that have come in. I guess I can see who my real friends are. Isn't that right, Gwen?
Absolutely right, Miss Fairchild. I'm right here by your side, whatever happens.
Crap, here comes breakfast. Somebody shut her up.
Camille, let's talk about this.
Oh, we're talking all right, Zachary. Or better yet, I'm talking, and you are going to do all of the listening. I have already spoken to the studio executives, and due to the recent increase in my popularity, we're renegotiating my contract and my position on Pryde and Joy.
Who's renegotiating your contract? That's supposed to be my job.
I don't think so. If I can't rely on you to keep me a leading part in a movie, I certainly can't trust you with something as important as my salary demands. No, I think I'll handle this delicate matter personally. I'll save a fortune by not having to pay an agent. Eric, I probably would have fired you a long time ago if it wasn't for the fact that you have a set of sexy buns and adorable dimples. Isn't that right, Gwen?
I've seen better.
Yes, Miss Fairchild.
This should be good. You have no idea what it takes to get a decent deal out of a studio. Wait a minute. What did you say about my buns?
If I have any questions, I will just ask Dakota Fanning. I'm sure she can give you the inside scoop on all of your tricks, you backstabber.
Oh, give me strength.
Oh, you'll need it, you washable bat. Because as far as I'm concerned, your career is kaput. I am being named an executive producer of the show. And with that title comes certain privileges, such as hiring and firing. So, darling Hazel, oh, and precious Valerie, and dear, sweet Lance, you all can go ahead and start packing your things. You'll get the official word by the end of the day that your services are no longer required.
Camille, you can't do this!
Oh, no? Call the execs and ask them yourself. They will verify that I'm calling the shots over the cast and crew now.
That's fine with me. I'm sick of working with such a spotlight hog anyway. The farther I get from you, the better off I'll be.
Wherever it is, Hazel, it will not be far enough, but I promise you this, it will not be in Hollywood. I'll get Gwen working on making sure the three of you are blacklisted from every studio within a 100-mile radius of Los Angeles. Did you get that, Gwen?
I sure did, Miss Fairchild. I'll get right on that. Put the kibosh on the lush,
the slut
and the bedhopper.
Who you calling a slut?
That would be you, Trampolina.
Slut, don't put that down your throat.
Mallory, sit down and behave yourself.
You can't be serious about this, Camille. What exactly have I done to you to deserve this kind of treatment?
You have been nothing but a monster in a dress since the day you became a teenager. You better go ahead and get that boob job, sweetie. It'll improve your chances on getting a casting call for the next season of Dancing with the Stars. That's where all the slutty has-beens go for one last shot at stardom.
And where do I stand in this grand upheaval? Am I to be cast aside as well?
Oh, dear, dear Jeffrey, I wouldn't dream of having you dismissed. You've done nothing to incur my wrath. And besides, I miss hearing that silver tongue of yours.
You're not actually going to stay here and work with this witch, are you, Jeffrey? The only reason she wants you here is to lavish her with compliments.
Alas, I fear my choices are somewhat limited, and I do have my dignity to consider. My dignity, they're so very precious little to make my mortgage payments.
Fine. Stay here with that sleaze, you old goat. It's obvious that you can live without your dignity as long as you're getting a paycheck.
And what about us, Camille? Are we victims of your new regime also?
Oh, heavens no. Cast members can be replaced. Writers and directors, that's a different story. Max, I will need you to finish the scripts for the rest of the season. The original set you are working on, if you please. Oh, and Zachary, you'll be interested to know that I have also accepted the offer from Universal for the leading actress role in The Wolfman. Under one condition, that you have nothing to do with directing the movie. They should be in touch soon to rescind their offer. I need you here, directing Pryde and Joy, and nothing else. Gwen, call Universal. Make sure stipulation has been added to my contract.
Sure thing, Miss Fairchild. I'll do that right away.
Sure thing, Miss Fairchild. Whatever you say, Miss Fairchild. Absolutely, Miss Fairchild.
What are you, a parrot? If I get you a cracker, will you shut up?
If I get you some mouthwash, will you please use it?
Valerie, for the last time, sit down. Camille, you are unbelievable. Is there nothing you won't do to further your career?
I'm just playing the game, Zachary. If this is what I have to do to get ahead in Hollywood, I'm going to show you all that I can play with the best of them.
So what about me, Camille? What do you possibly have in store for me?
Oh, Peyton, darling, I wouldn't dream of having you dismissed. That would be completely heartless and far too cruel. No, I think you are an integral part on this show. And I need you to continue your duties as assistant. The only change that instead of Zachary, you'll take orders directly and exclusively from me.
The hell I will!
Excuse me? Do you think you can dictate to me what is and isn't going to happen on this show?
I'm not dictating anything. I don't want to be your slave for you to use and abuse. I've put up with your demands for 8 years, and it's done nothing but get consistently worse.
I thought for a long time that you might come to your senses, but that's a lost cause. You've gotten too big for those britches of yours, and it's time to bring you back to reality.
And just how do you propose to do that?
Just wait and see, sister! I'll have this all straightened out before lunch!
Lance, do you have any idea what she's talking about?
Not a clue.
She doesn't have anything! She's bluffing. She's obviously just trying to make a dramatic exit instead of slinking away with her tail between her legs.
How would you know anything about dramatic exits? You don't have a dramatic bone in that pratfall prone body of yours.
You just wait, you booze hound. While I'm holding an Academy Award, the only thing you will be holding is a bottle of cheap liquor.
Let me at her. I'll smack that smile from here to Anaheim.
Hazel, no. It's not worth it. She's not worth it.
Well, why not? I say let her at it. In case you didn't hear, we're all fired.
You touch me, you snot, and the next picture of you in the tabloids will be a mugshot, not a bikini spread.
Miss Fairchild, I implore you to please reconsider the folly of your actions. We will wholeheartedly admit that you are the primary source of the success of Pryde and Joy, but you still leave us. If there's one thing to be left in this apocalypse, well, it's that we function best as a team, and to separate us all now at this point would spell disaster for each and every one of us.
You can't honestly believe that, can you?
I most certainly do. You may be the brightest among us, but you still need a supporting cast to play against. And that's a cast we require the direction that young Zachary has been able to provide.
And without the Mr. Bodenstein's scripts laying the groundwork for us, we have no comedic direction.
Quick, somebody write that down. He may never pay me a compliment on my writing.
What about Peyton, Jeffrey? What part does she play in this?
Miss Summers is the glue that she binds all of us together. She's the one who enables that we have everything necessary to ensure a smooth and seamless transition from conception to reality. Without her assistance, we would be in a state of constant chaotic flux. And even you, Miss Fairchild, you must admit that you rely on her as much, indeed if not more so, than the rest of us.
Assistants are a dime a dozen. I can have Gwen fill Peyton shoes just like that.
You could have 100 Gwens and they wouldn't equal one Peyton.
I'll second that.
Why are you still here? Didn't I tell you to pack more things and go? The last one I want to see on this set is my soon-to-be two-timing ex-husband. I mean, boyfriend, or whatever.
Camille, why can't you get it through your head that the romance between you two was only a publicity stunt cooked up by the studio?
Because it became more than just a publicity stunt. Didn't it, Lance?
Oh, Lance. Sick.
Please, tell me you were drunk.
You, with her. Out of the way, breakfast is coming through.
All right, so it's true. But only for a little while. It all started one night. We were out late together. One thing led to another. Then, before you knew it.
And you never said a word to anyone?
Only to Peyton.
It figures.
So, you knew it was a mistake after it happened?
I guess. I mean, I tried to make it work at first, but it was just too much togetherness. Once the novel wore off, it was just more than I could take. I started talking to Peyton about how emotionally draining the whole thing was. But she was always so supportive and sympathetic. We kept talking and our talks got longer. Next thing you knew, we were dating. And then, before we knew it, we were in love.
But you couldn't give up on the whole fantasy, and it just made things more complicated.
I've tried to break it off so many times, but you just can't take a hint.
And what was so bad about spending time with me?
Do you really have to ask?
Shut up, you hack!
He's right, Camille. Your whole attitude is more than one person can take for long. I used to think it was just some act you put on while you were working, but I quickly found out that you're that way all the time.
What way?
A diva! You think the whole world revolves around you, and it's sickening! You treat everyone like they're below you. Even us.
That's ridiculous!
Oh, Camille, it's true and you know it. When we first started and nobody knew who you were great. Then Pryde and Joy took off and people recognized you for your talent, and it went straight to your head. You became absolutely impossible to work with, and practically intolerable to be around.
In simple terms, you're a bitch.
That's enough. You know, sometimes, believe it or not, you're not that far behind her. Like mother, like daughter, I guess.
Really? Oh God, now they're twins. Where's that delivery boy? I need a drink.
Hello? This is Gwen, Miss Fairchild's personal assistant. Let me see if she's available. She's not actually available right now. How about if I take a message?
Eric, is what Zach's saying true?
You know it, Cammie. If you didn't place yourself so high on the pedestal, maybe a studio or a director would be more willing to take a chance on you for a movie. You've got the talent to do film. I know it, and the casting directors have also told me so. Your problem is you want to be the next Meryl Streep in your first film. If you would try doing something lighter, something with some comedy in it, you would stand a much better shot at getting a part.
We'll see about that. I have offers coming out of my ears right now, remember? Gwen, what are you doing? Just bring me the phone. You want me to come over there? Is it important? How important? Oh, for heaven's sake, stop with the dramatics and bring me the phone. Tomorrow at 3. I'll be there. Goodbye.
What in the world? that all about?
I don't know, but it looks like the pregnancy test just came back positive.
Can you please stop coming up with these horrible scenarios? I'd rather have her be poked than to procreate.
Perhaps whatever should go off with her some comfort.
Well, go ahead. You're the only one she doesn't have a vendetta against.
Wait a minute, Jeffrey. I think we have a plot twist coming.
What are you talking about?
Well, here comes Peyton.
I'm guessing Camille just got a phone call.
How do you know?
I expected it. I also saw Gwen running away from here with heels in hand.
Peyton, what did you do?
Balance the scales, that's all.
What do you mean, balance the scales?
Well, I bet you are extremely pleased with yourself, aren't you? As a matter of fact, no. I didn't want to go this far. But you were out of control. I'm not going to stand here and let you play God with our lives and our careers. Even though it's okay for you to do it to me.
Somebody tell me what the hell's going on.
Camille, would you like the honors? Oh, no. I would hate to deprive you of your moment of glory. Go ahead. Tell him. Besides, I want to hear what lies you spread about me. I didn't spread any lies. I just helped a little correspondence go to certain studio executives.
What correspondence? Miss P, please tell me you did not lower yourself to a despicable level of behavior to sabotage Miss Fairchild's career.
I just took the letter from the Screen Actors Guild about Camille's incident and behavior and brought it to the attention of the producers. After that, it was all up to them. You had no right. That was none of your affair or your business.
I hate to say it, Peyton, but I agree with Camille. That was none of your business. I have to say, I'm disappointed in you.
Zach, the letter was addressed to Zach. And as his assistant, one of my duties is to open and sort his mail. And if you remember, I want to handle this in private. But he insisted I read it out loud. At that point, the news was public.
She's got a point, Max. Technically, the whole thing was between Zach and Camille at first. Zach was the one that gave the go-ahead to read it out loud.
It's not like it was a private incident. The media had a field day with what little bit they got a hold of.
All right. It's not an invasion of privacy, but I still don't like it. So, what else did they say?
Calls around the studios and executives. Oh, Eric, I think you were getting some calls recently.
I don't know. I was in too much of a hurry to find Camille. Keep taking calls. Hang on here. Good grief, I've got 12 messages. I better go check these. Hang on a second.
So now what?
So whatever's been told to Camille.
Cut to the chase. Is she fired?
You would love that, wouldn't you?
Honestly, no.
What?
Camille, I have nothing against you as an actress. In fact, I think you have a great deal of talent. The fact that we've been on the air for 8 years can testify to that. I just get tired of dealing with your ego all the time. If you would act in a more professional manner, I wouldn't have to drink all the time to just put up with you.
Okay, I get it. I'm a diva and an egomaniac and a bitch. You won't have to put up with that any longer. I'm sure after tomorrow I'll be fired from the show.
Why tomorrow? Why didn't they just tell you now?
I don't know. They took everything else away from me. The movie deals, the executive producer title, all of it.
Hey, do you know anything about that?
Perhaps.
Well, don't just stand there. Tell us.
I really shouldn't, but it's not confidential or anything.
What? What else is going to happen to me?
Yeah, what's going to happen to Camille?
Are you on her side now?
Well, she's been my mom for 8 seasons. We can't spend that much time together and not form some kind of attachment. When her head's not so big, she has a cool moment now and then.
I'm shocked. I mean, I never thought you would all have a change of heart and rally up behind Camille.
So, who's the heartless bitch now?
Don't push it. You have no idea what I've agreed to get this all worked out. And I can still change my mind. Then you will be screwed.
Change your mind about what, Miss P?
I think the studio wanted to have Camille stew about this overnight, you know, to give her a taste of her own medicine. But here's the deal, Camille. I got them to keep you on the show, provided you change your behavior.
You what? How did you accomplish that?
You should be getting calls about that pretty soon. I also got the deal to stay intact for you to stay on the show as well. They'll give you a break and loan you out to Universal to do the Wolfman movie. You can also come back to us as a creative consultant and technical director.
Wait a minute. What about and the lead role in the Wolfman?
That deal is dead. Universal's already trying to sign Charlize Theron for the part instead.
You're gonna get to direct Charlize, you bloody son of a gun!
I mean, she wasn't my first choice, guys, but I guess she'll just have to do.
The fates have a deep smile upon you, young Zephyr. She is a sight to behold. Jeffrey Dinsmore, you have a thing for Charlize Theron.
I may have devoted my life to the genius of Shakespeare, but I still recognize and appreciate beauty when I see it. And from my most humble opinion, Miss Theron stands out from the multitudes.
So you don't know what the Wolfman is, but you have a thing for Charlize Theron? I'm gonna wolf my cookies again.
Going on. What else did I say?
I've also agreed to step in as director for Zach, and we're keeping our same format. We're a live sitcom, and that's not going to change.
You are going to direct me.
It's not. It's part of the deal, Camille. Don't fly off the handle until you've heard of all of what of all has been discussed. I need you to tell me what works and what doesn't, you and the rest of the cast. We need to work together to make it a success. You also need to trust me.
And why in the world would I trust you?
Because I know you really wanted to do a movie deal, and I got them to agree. And there's a new movie coming out with Will Ferrell, and it's a comedy, but it's a star.
You did that for me?
Yeah. But I didn't do it just for you. I did it for Lance and me.
It's not like they're doing anything wrong.
Guess there's no sense in fighting it. It's obvious he loves you anyway. Go ahead. Take him. With my blessing.
Have I told you just how wonderful you are?
Not lately, but you can start.
Real nice, Camille. Maybe there's hope for you yet.
Sure. Hope. But what am I gonna do about a boyfriend? I get lonely too.
I can't help you with that one. But with your upcoming personality, I think you can attract someone.
But I don't want to wait. I want one now.
I know a couple of guys who dealt with corpses on CSI. I could probably hook you up.
I'm not sure if I'm ready for the concept of a mother-daughter double date. And besides, I want someone with a personality. I don't want to spend an evening with some stiff.
Stiff? Corpses. Camille, I wouldn't even have made that pun.
It's going to take time for me to get used to having civil conversations again.
Well, this is just peachy. From what I'm hearing, everything works out happily ever after. Peyton and Lance get each other. Camille gets to keep her job and gets a movie deal. Zach gets a horror film to direct. Max, Jeffrey, Valerie, they all get to keep their jobs because the series is still on the air. It's a fairy tale ending, except for me. What does the poor, abused, and recently fired agent get out of all this?
I'm sorry, Eric. I would have gotten you a benefit out of this, but... Camille, do you have any ideas?
Oh, I get it. This is the big test. Can I really change? Well, I'm going to have a shot at a movie career. I will need someone to negotiate for me. And to be honest, I don't understand any of that legal gibberish anyway. Eric? Will you please agree to represent me again?
I don't know. I'm gonna have to think about this. I'm not just gonna come back to the way things were. There's gonna have to be some negotiations between us.
Can we discuss that sometime over dinner?
You're asking me out on a date?
I'm asking you out to dinner to discuss a business partnership. Any other perks to come with that relationship? We'll see.
How could I say no to a face as pretty as yours? At least to dinner. The rest, let's talk.
For the love of Jack Daniels, somebody get me a flask! I can't take any more of this!
You are putting into this, Hazel? And say those magic words that end every Hollywood classic.
What magic words?
Those three little words that let the audience know it's a happy ending and the show is over.
Oh, those words. You mean...
Vessels!